All right, so I think we can put an end to the polling now in case. All right, let me give you 30 more seconds since some of you have just joined. Quickly, all those who joined just now, quickly go through the poll questions. There are four questions. Please give out your best answer. There is no right or wrong answer to any question. All right. Okay. So I generally conduct the poll to get a sense, an idea of the kind of audience that I'm targeting, because that is something that I need to know, without which I'll not be able to address all the questions that you may have. Address all the things that I want to take up in the session. So that is the reason why I usually conduct a poll. The poll has given me a fair insight of what I can expect from an audience. So the first question, how many questions from probability do you think are tested in the QR section? About so almost equal number of people have said 1 to 3 and 3 to 5. A very small percentage think that it is 5 or more, and about 15% are not sure. I'll come back to that question and give you the exact answer on that in a bit. Okay. The second question was, is knowledge of PNC, permutations and combinations, required for solving probability questions? So that is where there was a mistake from my end, but I hope all of you understood the question in the way it had to be. So almost 80% of you have said yes. When do you plan to take the GRE? So more than half of you are taking it within the next 3 months, and about 25% almost are taking it within the next 1 year. And a minuscule, a small percent, you've still not thought about it. Okay, that's not a problem. For how long have you been preparing for the GRE? More than half of you have just started your preparation, and about 38% have been doing it for the last 3 months. Okay, all right, fair enough. So before we start off on the webinar, I would like to reiterate a few hygiene factors that I want all of us here to follow. First thing, I will be using the chat box more than the question and answer feature of this application. So do not type in your questions in the question and answer box. Hold on to your questions. If you have questions, please write them down on a piece of paper. At any stage of the webinar, if there is a new question that crops up in your mind, please write the question down then and there, and hold on to your questions till I complete the webinar. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the webinar, so that is when I'll take all your questions. In case you're facing any difficulty on the webinar in terms of connectivity issues, you're not able to hear the audio, there's a lag, please type your problems, or let me know by typing it in the chat box. Please don't type anything in the question and answer box. Point number three, please do not use the raise hand function. It's almost ineffective because I'll not be able to, respond to all the hand raises. So try not to use the feature of the hand raise. Try to type in your queries or doubts in the chat box. If there's a particular question that I think can be taken up at that particular stage of the discussion, I will take it up then and there. Otherwise, I will reserve my answers to your questions to the question and answer session of this webinar. All right. I hope I've been clear on that. I'll share my screen in a while. The first thing that I want all of you to do is, once I share my screen, I want all of you to type in an answer of yes if you're able to see the screen, and type in a no if you're not able to see the screen. Before we do that, let's do a quick check of the audio. Are you all able to hear my voice clearly? Please type in your answers in the chat box. Say a yes if you're able to hear me. Say a no if you're not. All right. So yeah, okay. That's done. That's a comprehensive yes from all of you. So I don't think there's a problem with the audio. All of you are able to hear me. All right. So I'll share my screen now. And you should be able to see the first screen in my PowerPoint presentation. I've not gone to the presenting mode yet. So if you're able to see the first slide of the screen, please type in a yes in the chat box. All right, so that's okay. So that's taken care of as well. Okay, great. So this is the webinar that we have for today. We are going to give you a few suggestions, a few ideas on how you can improve your strike rate or accuracy on probability questions that come up in the GRE Quant section. That is the title for today's webinar, and that's the agenda. So a few ground rules for this session. We want to make the session as organized, as clean as possible, because the end objective is for both of us, for me as well as all of you, to get the best out of what we intend to cover this in this webinar. So responses to the class are on the chat window, as I told you earlier. Please don't type in your questions in the question and answer box. And as I told you already, hand raises will not be responded to. If you have something, you can type it in the chat box, because I'll not be able to respond to a lot of hand raises. It will just probably hamper the flow of the webinar. So I would prefer not to respond to hand raises. Instead, I would prefer to probably respond to a good question on the chat window, if I feel it deserves a discussion at that moment. Generally, you don't have a reasons to expect a lag due to the connectivity issues. If all of you are facing a lag, then the problem could be from our end. If there's a lag of more than 10 seconds, please let me know in the chat window. If all the others are not facing a problem and one of you is facing a problem for over 10 seconds, then the problem, the connectivity issue could be from your end, right? I hope I'm clear on that. The agenda for today's webinar is about 60 minutes of discussion of certain important concepts along with problems, and a 15 to 20 minutes question and answer session at the end of the 60 minute discussion. So as I told you, please reserve your questions. Please write them down somewhere so that you don't miss out on anything important that you wanted to ask me, and keep them handy till we arrive at the stage of the question and answer session. All right. So let's get started with the webinar. This is where I go back to the poll, and let me have a look at the poll. I'm pretty sure that all of you are also able to look at the poll screen now. The first thing, how many questions from probability do you think are tested in the QR section? About 38% of you answered that about 1 to 3 questions are tested in the QR section. Another 38% voted for 3 to 5. A small 8% voted for 5 or more. 15% of you are not sure. Well, there's no accurate answer to this. We can only give you a ballpark figure of how many questions you can expect from probability in the QR section. At this point in time, I'm hoping that all of you know how the quant section of the GRE is in terms of the number of questions. There are 20 questions in every QR section, out of which you can expect about 1 to 3 questions from probability on any given day, on an average, right? The key word here is on an average. On an average, you can get 1 to 3. On a given day, it might also go up to 4, but on an average, it is not 3 to 5, it is not 5 or more. So about 10% to 15% of the questions in the QR section will be from probability, which is a decent chunk of questions that you can prepare for. So you cannot afford to leave out those 2 or 3 questions, as you know that leaving out any question in the GRE will give you a penalty, right? So you might as well prepare for it in a good way. The second question is knowledge of PNC required for solving probability questions? Excuse me for the mistake. I meant, is knowledge of PNC required for solving probability questions? And the answer is definitely a yes. There are a lot of PNC concepts that you are required to know to solve certain types of probability questions. Those types of questions account for almost 70% of the questions that come up in probability, right? So if there are 10 questions in probability, you will need to know PNC concepts to be able to solve at least 6 to 7 of them, right? So having cleared that part, I think we can go ahead now and quickly look at some basic concepts. So when you look at probability, you would have heard some of these terminologies very frequently. You would have heard of a terminology called a random experiment. Now, what is a random experiment? It's also called a non-deterministic experiment. So it's an experiment where the outcomes are uncertain. In the brackets, you can see that I've written not unknown, right? When you conduct an experiment where the outcomes are certain, right? All the experiments that you conducted in your science laboratories, where experiments where you knew what the outcomes would be. So for example, you knew that if sodium was added to chloride, you would get common salt, NaCl, right? That there the result was known. So it was certain. So there was no scope for calculating probability there. Whereas in a random experiment, the outcomes, although you know all the outcomes, you're not sure, you're not certain, you're not definite what outcome will finally come out. For example, if I toss a coin, a fair coin, I know that I will get either a head or a tail as a result. I know the results, right? But eventually, finally, what will come out as a result is something that I'm not sure of, right? None of us can be sure of the result till it comes out, correct? So imagine an experiment of throwing a fair dice. We know that when we throw a dice, we will end up getting some result, some number from 1 to 6. But we're not sure of what is the final number that is going to, come up on the face, on the top surface as the dice settles down, right? So all those experiments where the results are uncertain, where the outcomes are uncertain, are called random experiments. And because the results are uncertain, there is scope for us to calculate the probability of a particular outcome or a particular set of outcomes. Okay? Now, Now, you might definitely be knowing the actual meaning of the word outcome. And here, even in the context of probability, the word outcome means the result. But here, more specifically, the word outcomes means all the results of a random experiment. So for example, if I conduct an experiment of, let's say, throwing a fair dice, the total outcomes possible for me are 6, which means I can get any number from 1 to 6. I can get a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or a 6, right? If I conduct an experiment of tossing a fair coin, I have 2 results or 2 outcomes, right? If I conduct an experiment of picking a card from a pack usually consists of 52 cards. So picking a card from a pack has a total of 52 outcomes, right? So I hope that the word outcomes or the terminology outcomes is clear to all of you by now. Sorry about that. Last but not the least, probably the most important terminology that all of you have to, you know, understand, the word events. What does the word events mean? It means that you have a subset of the results of a random experiment. So if I've given an example below to, you know, give you a better idea. Imagine if we conducted an experiment of throwing a fair dice, and this experiment, as we understood, has 6 total outcomes. Now, it is upon us, the responsibility lies with us to define an event. So we could define an event of getting an odd number. Now, if you look at this event, out of the 6 outcomes possible, there are 3 outcomes which will satisfy this event. Now, what are those 3 outcomes? The 3 outcomes are 1, 3, and 5, right? So if I define another event, like getting an even number, out of the total 6 outcomes, 3 outcomes will again satisfy this event of getting an even number. And what are those outcomes? 2, 4, and 6. So give me a moment, I'll be able to write on the screen here. Just give me a moment, guys. Okay, so we'll get there eventually. So I hope the meaning of the terminology events is understood now. Once you understand the meaning of the word event, it is time to move on to the mathematical definition of probability of an event. So how is probability of an event defined mathematically is what I've put here as an equation. So P of E represents the probability of an event. It is equal to number of outcomes favorable to the event divided by total possible outcomes. So if I can take some examples here, so if I can, you know, write down a set of numbers here. So these are the outcomes that I can expect when I throw a dice, right? Now, for the event of getting an odd number, I know that this event is satisfied by 1, 3, 5. So if this is my event E, the probability of E will be, there are 3 outcomes that are satisfying my event. So number of favorable outcomes. So there are 3 outcomes that are favorable to my event divided by, there are 6 total possible outcomes. So 3 ones are 3, 3 twos are 6. So the probability of getting an odd number is 1 by 2. Similarly, if I define another event, let's say getting a prime number, I know that this event is again satisfied by three outcomes, 2, 3, and 5, because these are the prime numbers between 1 to 6, right? Now, the favorable outcomes are 3 in number. So, the probability of this event E, the probability of event E will be number of favorable outcomes, 3, divided by number of total possible outcomes here again for me is 6, which will come out to be half. So, this is how you mathematically calculate probability. There are two steps. One is to calculate the total possible outcomes. So, how do we calculate the total possible outcomes? The total possible outcomes is defined by the random experiment itself, right? So, if I throw a dice, the total possible outcomes will be 6. If I toss a coin, the total possible outcomes will be 2. If I throw 2 dice, the total possible outcomes will be 6 multiplied by 6 because there are 2 dice. So every value on the first dice corresponds to 6 values on the second dice, for example. If I can show you an example of So I have 2 dice. On the first dice, I can get a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. On the second dice, I can get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, right? So let us say on the first dice, if I got a 1, this along with this 1, I can get a 1, or I can get a 2, or I can get a 3, or I can get a 4, or I can get a 5, or I can get a 6. So for every 1 value, there are 6 values here. There are 6 values here, so the outcome will be 6 multiplied by 6, that is 36. So therefore, summarizing, while calculating the probability of any event mathematically, the first thing that you have to calculate is the total possible outcomes, because that is the easiest thing to find out, because it depends on the random experiment that you are conducting, right? The total possible outcome is also called the sample space. So whenever you're solving a problem on probability, your energy should be focused on trying to find out the total possible outcomes first based on the random experiment. Also remember that the total possible outcomes is calculated without applying any condition or constraint, right? There is nothing that constrains the total possible outcomes. We find out everything. Now, coming to the numerator, we can find out the number of outcomes favorable to the event only when we understand the event properly, right? For example, if the event is getting a natural number between 7 to 10. Now, obviously, if I throw a dice, I won't get a natural number between 7 to 10, right? So, understanding what the event is asking you is very important, because once you understand that, you will definitely be able to find out how many outcomes can satisfy or may not satisfy. So in the example that I just took, I know that there are no outcomes satisfying the event, right? So the numerator will be 0. 0 divided by anything, as we know, is a 0. And it is common sense that the probability of getting a 7 or a 8 when I throw a dice is 0. It is not possible. It's an impossible event, right? So when it comes to calculating probability, always treat it as a fraction. Calculate the denominator first based on the experiment. Calculate the numerator based on the event that is given in the problem. The event is something that will define the boundary conditions for the problem, right? Always keep that in mind. Also, the last point that I have put in this slide is, if probability P of E is the probability of the event happening, then P of E dash or E bar is the probability of the event failing. So the total probability will always be equal to 1. P of E plus P of E dash will always be equal to 1. We'll see how to make use or take advantage of this equation in certain types of problems when we come there. When we reach there, I'll explain you how to take advantage of this situation. All right. So we can now look at what is the first tip that we want you to understand. The first tip that will help you improve your accuracy, that will help you solve, get more answers correctly, is for you to learn to use the mathematical definition of probability. In fact, I can go to such an extent that I can say that if you know the mathematical definition of probability, you'll be able to solve at least 60 to 70% of the questions on probability. By which I'm telling you that it is the only one single equation that you need to know to be able to solve probability questions with almost a 60% strike rate, right? Now that's a lot. Think about it. You need to maintain a 75% to 80% strike rate in the quant section of the GRE. I'm telling you, of all the probability questions, just knowing the definition of probability will help you solve more than 60% of the questions. What else do you want? You just need to know how to make use of it in the best possible way. All right. That is the first thing that you need to know. So to test this out, let us take a problem. I have a simple problem for you. Go ahead. I'll time you all for 2 minutes. For every problem that we take up today, we'll have a timing of 2 minutes. To keep it a little competitive, I'll tell you when to start and you can start off from there. So you can start now. The 2 minutes time starts now. After you're done, you can probably type in your answers in the chat box. Meanwhile, I'll try to see how to get the pen functionality to work. I'm sorry, this is the question that you're solving. Okay, that's 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and that's time. Okay, so let's look at how to figure out the way around. So I have 75 tiles. The first step is always to, you know, do some groundwork in terms of simplifying some of the numbers, having all the numbers handy so that you can plug them in directly into the equation to make your own job simple, right? Now I know that there are three categories. Some of them are blue, some of them are green, and some of them are white. Now I know that one third of 75 is 25. So I know that 25 tiles are blue. Of the remaining, So out of 75, if I take out 25, so if I take out 25 out of 75, I'm left with 50, right? Of the remaining, how much of the remaining, 40% of the remaining. So 2 by 5, 40% is nothing but 2 by 5. So 2 by 5 of 50, right? Which is 10. So 2 tens are 20. So 40% of 50 are green. So 40% of the remaining tiles are green. So out of 75, we can account for 45 now. So the remaining 30 tiles are white, right? So this is the groundwork that I'm talking about. Now, the experiment that I'm conducting, the random experiment that I'm conducting, is I'm picking one tile at random, right? So my total possible outcomes will obviously be 75, because I can pick any one of the 75 tiles, right? So this is my denominator. So see how I have calculated, how I have done what I asked you guys to do. I have calculated the denominator first. I have calculated the sample space first, because that depends on the random experiment. Now, what is the probability that the selected tile will be white? So that selected tile has to be white. So this is my event. So this is my event E, right? So my numerator will be white tiles, right? And the white tiles are obviously 30. So my probability that the selected tile, whatever tile I selected, is a white tile, is given by the favorable outcomes. Favorable outcomes are 30 divided by 75, which is the total possible outcomes. 5 6 are 30, 5 15 are 75. 3 2s are 6, 3 5s are 15. So 2 by 5, or you can say 40%, both mean the same. 2 by 5 is the same as 40%. So 2 by 5 is your answer. So C for Charlie is your answer. So if I have to, you know, summarize what I did in this problem, first, I broke down the numbers so that I could use them readily in my calculations. That's also something that you guys have to start learn doing. Second, I focused on finding the denominator or the total possible outcomes based on the experiment that I conducted. Third, I tried to find out the numerator based on the event, which is defined here. Fourth, I didn't do anything. There was no rocket science. I just used the basic mathematical definition of probability of favorable outcomes divided by total possible outcomes to find my probability 2 by 5. So I hope, let me have a look at how many of you have given 2 by 5 as an answer. All right. Ash, 4 by 15 is, I'm sorry to say, the wrong answer. All right. Good. A fair number of you have given the answer as C. That is the right answer. This is probably an easy one. Let's look at probably another question on probability. Can you have a look at this? Can we all try? 2 minutes again. Time starts now. Also learn to make effective use of the time given. If you end up getting an answer within 40 seconds, 45 seconds, remember that there's still almost a minute left for you to go back, review your answer, and check whether you've got the right answer or not. Don't be in a hurry all the time. 30 seconds more. So that's time. Any answers till now? Please key in your best answer in the chat box. You may not have, some of you may have got the right answer, some of you may have got the wrong answer, you never know till you key in your answers. C. Okay, so I got another C for this question. Any other answers? C from Amol as well. A, Shikha. Okay, so I got a different answer here. D, okay, that's an interesting one. Okay, so I got a couple of A's here, a couple of C's, a D. All right. This question I could say is a little bit of a bouncer, a little bit of a googly. So if you did not get this question right, some of you got this answer wrong, do not lose your sleep over it. A lot of people tend to get this question wrong the first time that they do it, because they miss out on a few tricky aspects that are built into the problem. So I have company A, which has 400 employees. I have company B, which has 500 employees. Now, there are 50 married couples. So I hope all of you are observing how I write down the data that I can see from the problem, to ensure that I'm not missing out anything, or I'm not making statements like I thought it was like this, I assumed it was like this, and so on. Right? So whenever you have a lengthy word problem, please, you know, break it down into small parts, write them down, jot down the important things, and only then proceed with the problem. So I have 50 married couples, which means I have 50 husbands and 50 wives. Right? Now, there is more than one approach, you know, to get the answer right on this question. I'll take one of the approaches. Now, you could say that what is the probability of selecting a husband? Let us say the husband belongs to, all the husbands belong to company A, for example. Let's assume that case, because it makes our calculation simple. It's a hypothesis, but there's nothing wrong with that. So what is the probability of selecting the husband? I know that in company A, there are 400 employees. So my total possible outcomes will be 400, right? Because out of 400, I have to select one. So remember, 400 C1 is actually what is happening in the background, but because NC1 is N, we don't always write NC1. We just say it is 400 because we know that it is 400 C1 and 400 C1 is 400 itself. I hope I'm clear on that. So the total possible outcomes are 400. My favorable outcomes are 50, right? Because there are 50 husbands, because there are 50 married couples, right? So this is where I'm using the definition of probability. Favorable outcomes, total possible outcomes. Now, 50 by 400 is 1 by 8. Right? Now that I've selected a husband, now I need to find out the probability of selecting his wife, not a wife. Right? So you have to understand that here, it is probability of selecting a husband, but here, it is probability of selecting the wife. Right? because you are trying to see what is the probability that the employee that you selected will be a married couple. So you have to match the husband to the wife. Otherwise, of course, there are dangerous consequences, as we all know, on a lighter note. So let's assume that the wives work for company B. Right? I'm making it very convenient here, right, for the men. So in company B, there are 500 employees. So the total possible outcomes will be 500. So I can select any one of the 500, right? But out of the 500 that I select, there will only be one wife, because I'm trying to match the wife to a particular man that I've selected, right? So this probability will end up being 1 by 500. And because I have to select the husband and the wife, as all of you know, AND stands for multiplication. So selecting the husband, the probability is 1 by 8. And selecting the wife, the probability is 1 by 500. So it is 1 by 4,000. The most common mistake that all of us end up doing in this problem, or at least a lot of us can end up doing this mistake, is to take it as 50 by 400 into 50 by 500. What are we doing? What wrong are we doing here? Here, we are selecting, let's say, the husbands, but here we are selecting the wives. Whereas here we have to select a wife, because we'll have to find out whether they are a married couple or not. You cannot just match any husband with any wife. You have to match the husband with his wife. And out of the 50, there will only be one person, right? One wife for this fellow. That is why this cannot be 50. But this is the most common mistake. Look at this. 1 by 8 and this is 1 by 10, right? It's very easy to say, okay, 1 by 8 and 1 by 10 is 1 by 80. But 1 by 80 is the wrong answer. That's a common mistake. Firdos, there is one problem in this case. Why can't it happen vice versa? It can happen vice versa. The only thing that will change is you'll end up getting 1 by 100. So if I say I'll select the wives first, I will say 50 out of 500, right? So that'll be 1 by 100. And then out of 400, I have to select one husband. That is 1 by 400, right? So sorry, this is 1 by 10, not 1 by 100. So 1 by 10 into 1 by 400 will again give you 1 by 4,000, right? So I hope that is clear for those. Both that case is also possible, right? So this is one approach. Another approach could be, I'll show you that approach in a different, you know, screen, so that is clear. Another approach is, I know there are 500 employees in one company, 400 employees in another company. Let's not worry about A and B, right? Let's worry about how many husbands are there, how many wives are there. I have husband one, wife one, husband two, wife two, husband three, wife three. So on, I have it till husband 50 and wife 50, right? Now, what is the probability of this couple, husband one, wife one being selected? Husband one being selected is 1 by 500, or probably it is 1 by 400, depending on which company they work for, right? Because there will be one favorable case for husband one into 1 by 400, because there's only one favorable case for wife one. So the probability that husband one and wife one will get selected is 1 by 500 into 1 by 400, right? Similarly, the probability for this couple will again be the same, 1 by 500 into 1 by 400, because there's only one H2, there's only one W2, right? So if you continue like this, this 1 by 500 and 1 by into 1 by 400 saga, or this story of 1 by 500 into 1 by 400 will continue for 50 cases, right? In each case, the probability of that particular couple will be 1 by 500 into 1 by 400, right? So if we cancel off the zeros now, 5 tens are 50, you will eventually get the same answer. This is probably a much easier approach to the same problem. Okay, so I hope, I'm guessing that a lot of you probably prefer the second approach to the first approach, but that's how it is sometimes with respect to some questions. But again, in the first approach here, you saw that the only thing that I use is the definition of probability. That is, I use probability of an event is number of favorable outcomes divided by total possible outcomes, right? So whenever you look at a probability question, always think of finding out the total possible outcomes first in some way, and then follow it up with calculating the favorable outcomes. You will be able to solve at least 60% of the question. Trust me on that. All right. So that is tip number one. Tip number one is to use the mathematical definition to your advantage. Tip number two, use the PE plus PE dash equal to one to your advantage. Now, what happens here is I know P of E plus P of E dash equal to one, right? So sometimes if I want to find out PE, if I want to find out the probability of some event happening, it is easier to calculate P of E dash and then subtract it from one. Always remember, in all probability problems, the total probability, right, will always be one, right? Or you could say 100%. So mathematically, you cannot say, I am 120% sure that I'll clear the GRE. Mathematically, it is not possible, because mathematically, you can only be 100% sure that you'll clear the GRE, right? Because the total probability is one. So this total probability is one, from which you subtract the event not happening to get the probability of event happening, right? This is a commonly used tactic or a strategy in a lot of problems where the event that you're trying to calculate the probability for has many cases, or it is too time consuming. So in such cases, what we prefer to do is we prefer to calculate this, because they will have fewer cases, or it takes less time, and then subtract it from one to get the probability that we are looking for. Am I clear on this concept, guys? Can I get a few yeses or a noes or something? Clear? Great. Okay. All right. So let's look at the third question for the day. Have a look at this problem. Again, you have a time of 2 minutes. Starting now. Go ahead, solve it.
one more minute.
Okay, I got a few answers. 8 by 125, option C, option A. Again? A general piece of advice would be always try to use all the time that is allotted to you, especially when the topics are like foundation, conversion, and probability. So that's time. That's 2 minutes. Alright. So here we have 100 marbles. Out of which 40 are red and 60 are blue. One of the reasons why this, you know, this word 40 is given here instead of giving it as 40 numerically would probably be to just put you off mislead you, or to kind of test your observation skills. So be careful about that. So the first time, so there are two approaches. Again, I'll demonstrate both and tell you why the second approach is maybe superior. So there are three consecutive picks with replacement, which means once I pick a marble, I'll replace it back into the bag before I pick the second time, right? Now, what is the probability of getting at least one red marble in three consecutive picks with replacement of the marble each time? So what is the, this is not a good idea. At least one red. What is the meaning of this? It means I'm ready to get one red, two red, or all the three red. I'm okay with all this, but I am not okay with no red, right? I need to get at least one red marble means I need to get one or more red marbles in the three picks, right? So I can get a red here, a blue here, a blue here, for example, or I can get a red, blue here, or I can get all the three reds, right? So there are three cases. I'm one of them is getting one red marble, or two red, one blue. So I missed out one part here. One red, two blue. Don't forget that. Or all the three red, right? Now, one red, two blue. 40, right? 40 into 60C2. Why 60C2? Because there are 60 blue marbles out of which I can select any two. There are 40 red marbles out of which I have to select any one, right? Divided by, what should I put in the denominator here? You can type in the chat box. Is my approach right here? Is my approach right, or should I follow a different approach? One red, two blue, two red, one blue, three red. Okay, let us go ahead with this. 40 into 62. What should I put in the denominator? A few of you can type into the chat boxes. 100 or 200? 100. Why 100? Because there are 100 marbles, right? Okay. Okay. After that, what should I do? I need 200 here, so 40 C2 into 60 divided by 100, right? Or 40 C3, 40 C3 is because I want all the red here, divided by 100, correct? Because 100 is the common denominator, you can keep 100 as common and add all the values, correct? Am I right here? Okay, so you see how big an expression that you got if you follow this approach. So this is your event, right? So the event is you want either one red or two red or three red, right? Please elaborate on C2. What is C2, Firdaus? I'm not able to understand what C2 means. Okay, we'll eventually get to that. Don't worry. So the more important point I'm trying to make here is, this is what will happen in some cases if you try to find the probability of an event, all right? Because it has too many cases and the expression can get complicated. I'm not worried whether the expression is fully right or fully wrong. The only point I'm trying to make is, expressions can get bigger. So what can we do? I'll demonstrate that in a different window, so that you have the contrast between the two, right? Now, I'll try to find out the probability of no red. No red means in the first instance, in the first pick, I will get 60 out of 100, right? 60 out of 100 is any one marble out of 60 out of 100. So favorable outcomes, total outcomes. Second pick also, because I don't want any red, I will pick blue, right? Third pick also, because I don't want any red, I'll pick blue. Now, 60 by 100 is nothing but 3 by 5. So the probability that my event fails, why am I saying event fails? Because I am considering the event here as no red, but I actually want one red, right? So this is the probability of my event failing, that is 27 by 125. Therefore, the probability of my event happening should be equal to 1 minus probability of my event failing, right? Which is nothing but 1 minus 27 by 125, which will be 98 by 125. That is your option C. Option A is just a trap here. We know that some of you will do 2 by 5 into 2 by 5 into 2 by 5, which actually means nothing in this problem. It only means one case, and the one case is this case, 3 red. Okay? This expression is wrong. I just wanted to see how many of you will say whether it's wrong or not. Unfortunately, because of the mechanism in which we are taking answers, that could not happen here. This is the probability of 3 red. 2 red will be 2 by 5 into 2 by 5 into 3 by 5. 1 red will be 2 by 5 into 3 by 5 into 3 by 5. Right, and we add up all the cases and then get to the answer. All right, but again, as I told you, there are 3 cases, and you have to calculate for each case, which can get cumbersome. So I hope that is clear. Yes, Abhijit Kumar. Yes, that is what we did. Right, that is eventually where I came to. I wanted to highlight that. The point I wanted to highlight is the actual way, the taking the cases is actually more time consuming. Okay, all right, let's go to the next question. All right, let's look at this. So I'll time you again, 2 minutes. So because this is a question that is lengthy, it's only fair that I give you a little more time. So I'll give you 3 minutes on this. Time starts now. Guys, a minute and a half. I got a D, I got a B. A minute more. D again, okay. One more D from Amol, okay. Five, four, three, two, one, and that's time. So, yeah, I ended up giving you one more minute extra here because I felt the question is worded that way. It's a lengthy word problem. However, this is what I want you guys to remember here. P of E is what we are trying to find out. It is 1 minus P of E dash. So in our case, probability, the event that we want to happen or the event that we wish will take place is that Leo will hear a song, right, on one of the stations. This should be equal to the total probability minus the probability that he will not hear a song on any of the three stations, right? This is the easy way out. So the probability of not hearing a song on any of the three stations will obviously be equal to the probability that he did not hear the song on station one. On station one, it is 0.7, because for each station, the probability is 0.3 that the station is playing a song that Leo likes. So if the probability that the song is being played is 0.3, the song not being played will be 0.7, right? So at the first station, 0.7. On the second station also, we don't want him to hear a song, 0.7. On the third station also, we don't want him to hear a song, 0.7. Because we are looking at the probability that he will not hear a song that he likes, right? So 0.7 into 0.7 into 0.7, 777, 7 cube, 343, right? So it will be 0.343, 0.343. Therefore, the probability that he will hear a song, right, that he likes should be 1, that is the total probability, minus 0.343, right? So in almost 34.3% of the cases, he will not hear any song. So from the total probability, if you subtract it, you can say that the probability that he'll hear a song that he likes on at least one of the stations, it could be A alone, B alone, C alone, or it could be on any two of the stations, or it could also be on all the three, right? We don't need to worry about what case it is. We just know that the sum of all those probabilities will come up to be 0.657 eventually, right? Because it is logical, right? So 657 is the right answer here. The trap answer is one of them is A, because some of you might end up doing 0.3 into 0.3 into 0.3, which is wrong. 0.3 is the probability that he likes the song, but here you're only considering one case. This case is when he hears the song on all the three, but there are other cases, right? This is 0.090 is another trap wherein you can commit a mistake, right? You can just say 0.3 into 0.3 and forget about the other 0.3, right? So these are two trap answers. The right answer is option D. So I hope that is clear. So that concludes point number two. Tip number two is, please use the P of E is equal to 1 minus P of E dash concept to solve the same problem in lesser time with lesser stress on your brain, right? Because you want to preserve your mental energy for a longer period of time. So don't just utilize it to just keep writing down cases after cases and eventually get the same answer. It'll just be a waste of investment, right? All right. Tip number three, learn to apply the concepts that you learned in permutations and combinations. Some of you who did probability in higher math in high school, maybe 11th, 12th, would remember that a lot of problems in probability could be solved using combinations concepts, something called binomial probability distribution. But that is not what I'm touching on here. I'm looking at using permutations instead of combinations, you know, to help you solve problems in probability which have cases. So till now, what we have done is we have solved problems of individual events. Now, we will solve problems on complex events, which means there are multiple cases involved. So you have to take into consideration all the cases before calculating the total probability. So probability of a complex event is equal to probability of an individual event multiplied by the number of cases. How do we find the number of cases? This is where we use the permutation concepts to help us out. So for example, we understand that if I have a word like apple, the total number of permutations of this word will be 5 factorial divided by 2 factorial, right? 5 because there are 5 objects, divided by 2 factorial because there are 2 P's, right? Another example, if I have a word like essay, again, here, the total number of permutations or the arrangements will be 5 factorial by 2 factorial, right? Because there are 5 objects out of which 2 are repeating. Let's have an example of this word, Mississippi. Right? So here, 4, 8, 11. So 11 factorial because there are 11 objects, divided by 4 factorial because there are 4, because the letter S is repeating 4 times, 4 factorial because I is repeating 4 times into 2 factorial because p is repeating twice, right? So some of you may already know this concept. For some of you having, you know, taking the me taking these examples has probably refreshed your memory about these kind of problems, right? Let us now look at how to use these, you know, this concept in solving a problem. All right. So let us look at the next question, which is this. 2 minutes. Starting now. Sorry. 30 seconds. All right, that's time. So although it seems like there is no data about the probabilities here, you have to understand that there are words like equal likelihood, which give you a clue about the probability. Sarah times her morning commute such that there's an equal likelihood that she will arrive early or late to work on any given day. So the probability that Sarah is early is half, and the probability that she is late is also half, because they say there is an equal likelihood, equal chance that she will either arrive early or late, right? Which means she never arrives on time, right? Which is something that we can conclude from this statement, but it is corroborated by the next statement. If she always arrives either early or late, right? So our conclusion is actually, we have concluded on the right, if we are on the right track, right? What is the probability that Sarah will arrive late to work no more than twice, right? During a 5-day work week. So there are 5 days. We don't want her to be late for more than twice. So she can be late maximum of 2 times, which means on 5 days, out of 5 days, if she's late for 2 days, on the other 3 days, she's early. Or it says no more than twice. So either 2 or 1, right? So she could also be late on 1 day and be early on the next 4 days. Or the best case is that she could be late on none of the days, and therefore she could be early on all the 5 days. So these are the 3 cases where she is late to work no more than twice. She's not late to work more than 2 days, right? Now here, it is not necessary that this has to happen in the same order, right? There are 5 objects, out of which 3 are alike. So divided by 3 factorial, 2 are alike. So into 2 factorial, right? This is the number of cases. What are the number of cases here? Let us see. Here there are 5 objects. Again, there are 4 objects which are similar. So 4 factorial. Here there are 5 objects, all of which are similar. So 5 factorial divided by 5 factorial, right? So either this will happen, or this will happen, or this will happen, right? 5 factorial by 3 factorial to 2 factorial is 10. 5 factorial by 4 factorial is 5. 5 factorial by 5 factorial is 1. This is the number of cases. Now, if you look at the individual probability, in each case, the individual probability is 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2, right? Because whether Sarah is arriving late or early, the probability is 1 by 2. Whichever case you take, for example, you take L, L, E, 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 right? This probability will be 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, and 1 by 2, which is what I have represented here, right? So 1 by 32. So as I told you, this is the probability of an individual event. So the probability of the complex event will be individual probability into the number of cases. Now, how many cases do we have? We have 16 cases. So the probability will finally be 16 into 1 by 32, that is 1 by 2. So the correct answer here is C for Charlie. I hope I have been clear on this in terms of explaining you how to take cases. I hope all of you have understood this explanation. Ash, 17 by 32 seems to be wrong. It has to be half the time, 16 by 32. Please check your calculations. You might have done a... Firdaus, why is 1 by 2 5 times? Because you're looking at a 5-day work week, right? So on the first day, the probability of Sarah will be half and half and half and half and half, right? So there are 5 days. So that is the reason why you have to take it 5 times, one after the other. All right? Okay, so let's get to the next question now. So here the probability is already given to you. Go ahead. This time, I'll give you lesser time, 1 minute 30 seconds, because I want to kind of simulate what happens on the GRE, and also because we are running out of time. So 1 minute 30 seconds. And that's time. Okay. Any answers on this, guys? C. So I got a couple of C's. Okay. Oops. What did I do? Okay. So the probability of rain in Rwanda is half as given. Therefore, the probability of no rain is R dash, is also half, right? Because the total probability has to be 1. What is the probability that it rains on 4 out of 7 consecutive days? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I have 7 consecutive days, out of which I want rain on 4 days. For example, it might look like this. I might have no rain on 3 days, R dash. It might also look like this. R, R, R dash, R dash, R, R dash, R, right? So it's our job to calculate how many cases are possible like this. Obviously, it's not possible to do it manually. But before that, let us look at what is the individual probability of one case, right? So if we calculate the individual probability of one case, it's obviously 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2. How many times? 7 times, because there are 7 days, right? So this is the individual probability for one case. But we do know that there is not one case, but there are many cases. So let us see how many cases are there. The number of cases will be 7 factorial, because there are 7 objects, 7 days, divided by 4 factorial, because there are 4 hours, into 3 factorial, because there are 3 R dashes, right? So this will give me all the different permutations I can make out of the 4 R's and the 3 R dashes, correct? So 7 factorial divided by 4 factorial, 3 factorial will be 7 into 6 into 5. Remember, 4 factorial will get cancelled, divided by 3 into 2 into 1, right? 3 2's are 6, so 35. Now therefore the probability for the entire event will be number of cases, 35, multiplied by the individual probability of one case. So this is the individual probability of one case, and there are 35 such cases, right? That is 35 by 128. So again, the answer here is C, right? So whenever there are complex events, always try to find out the probability of the one individual case. Separately find out how many cases are there, then multiply both to get the probability of the complex event, right? So I hope that is clear. So because we are running out of time, I have to skip a couple of questions, right? Or maybe I'll skip question number 7. Move on to question number 8. Why don't we take this up? Again, 1.5 minutes. 1 minute 30 seconds for this. So those 128 is 2 power 7. So that is where we got it from. Time up. So what's the answer, guys? D. Okay. Interesting. I finally got an A. Okay. So A is the most common trap answer here, because we tend to interpret this in a different way. We think a sharpshooter hits the target once every 3 shots, and we forget the phrase "on an average." And therefore we go on to say, okay, in 3 shots, he is able to hit once. So obviously, if I give him 4 shots, definitely out of 4 shots, he'll hit once. And therefore the probability is 1, which is why the first option is given as 1, because we know that that's a common trap that some of you will get into. Now, what this, how this has to be interpreted is the probability of, you know, hitting the target is 1 out of 3, right? Once every 3 shots means out of every 3, he'll hit once. Now, that he might hit in the first shot, he might hit in the second shot, he might hit in the third shot, right? The probability of missing, therefore, will be 2 by 3, right? Now, we are given 4 shots. What is the probability that he'll hit the target within 4 shots? So we want him to hit within 4. This obviously involves a lot of cases. He might hit in the first shot, he might hit in the second shot, he might hit in the third shot, he might hit in the fourth shot, right? So there are 4 different cases you have to take care of. Therefore, what I'll do is, I will find out the probability of missing all the 4. Right? The probability of missing all the 4 is 2 by 3 into 2 by 3 into 2 by 3 into 2 by 3. Right? He misses on the first, misses on the second, misses on the third, misses on the fourth, which is 2 power 4, 16, 3 power 4, 81. So if I want to find the probability that he hit the target within 4 shots, from the total probability, I just have to subtract 16 by 81, because 16 by 81 times, he is not hitting the target, even after giving him 4 shots, right? So if you remove that from the total probability, whatever is left will take care of all the cases that we discussed, that is 65 by 81. So 65 by 81 will take care of all the different cases that we discussed, right? So here is where I've used the P of E equal to 1 minus P of E dash principle to my advantage, right? By finding out 16 by 81 first and then subtracting it from 1, so that I don't have to worry about all the cases that have to be taken up. So I hope that is clear. 1 is not the answer, right? Okay. For the last question of the day, this is a challenger question, for which I'll give you 2 minutes, because it's a challenger question, after which we can have the question and answer session. Timer started, so I hope all of you are solving. Thirty seconds more. So I got a B already. All right, that's time up. Any other answers apart from B? So this is a QC question, a quantitative comparison question, where the options are A, B, C, and D. I hope all of you are aware of the options already. So four people each roll a fair die once. So I have four people rolling a die. First, second, third, fourth, right? The probability that at least two people will roll the same number. So probability that at least two have the same number. Now again, here, there are a lot of cases. Two people having the same number, three people having the same number, four people having the same number, right? So there are three cases. So what I'll do is, I'll calculate the probability of none having the same number. What is the meaning of none having the same number? It means it is a probability of all of them having different numbers. Right? So this person should have a number that is different from this. So these two should be different, right? These two should be different. These two should be different. Now, what is the probability for the first person to pick a number? It is one, right? Because he can pick any six out of the six numbers. Now, for the second person, the probability that he will pick a number that is different from this person is 5/6, because he cannot pick the number that this first fellow picked, right? Now, the probability for the third person will be 4/6, because he cannot pick the number that these two people picked. And lastly, for the fourth person, the probability will be 3/6, because he cannot pick the numbers that these three people picked, right? So probability that all the numbers are different will be 60, 5, 4 are 20, 23 are 60, 60 by 6 cube, 216, right? Therefore, the probability that at least two of them will have the same number will be total probability minus probability that all of them have different numbers, which is 60 by 216. So we have, if we can simplify 60 by 216, 6 tens are 60, 6 36 are 216, 2 fives are 10, 2 18s are 36. So we have this as 5 by 18. So 1 minus 5 by 18 will be 13 by 18. And 13 by 18 is approximately 72%. So quantity A comes out to be 72%. It's actually 72.22, but approximately it is 72. So here, quantity A is definitely more than quantity B. The answer for this question will be option A, because the first quantity is greater, right? Now, therefore, we come to the end of, you know, problem solving. Let me summarize. We discussed three tips. Tip number one, make use of the mathematical definition of probability as much as possible to solve at least 60% of the questions. Tip number two, make use of probability of the event equal to total probability minus probability of the event failing, P of E equal to 1 minus P of E dash. That's another very effective strategy that you can adopt in a lot of questions, as we just saw in the challenger question also. Tip number three, when there are complex events where the event consists of number of cases, make use of the permutation concept to find out how many cases are there, multiplied with the individual probability to get the total probability, right? So these are three simple strategies that you can adopt in some of your probability questions to improve your strike rate. It's natural that your strike rate will not go up to 100%. You will end up getting maybe one odd question wrong, but it'll definitely improve your confidence level and you'll feel more comfortable about having improved your strike rate and probability. Because remember, the questions on probability usually come up in the hard levels. So you'll never have a level 2 or a level 1 probability question. It will always be either level 3 or level 4 or level 5. All right. Now, I think we can have maybe about 5 to 10 minutes on some of the questions that you have. So if any of you do not know what CrackVerbal, this is who we are. We were founded in 2006, and by now we have coached more than 5,000 students to take up either the GMAT or the GRE. Our students are, they come from more than 37 countries. So we service students from different countries other than India also. Basically, we connect students to persons who love, teaching and mentoring. That is who we are. That is the kind of individuals we are in this company. So we have some free resources to get you started off. So I'll copy paste these links in the chat box. So meanwhile, I would request some of you to start typing their questions. We have about 5 to 10 minutes for the question answer session. I'll quickly copy paste the links for you guys so that you can access some of these free resources. We have great GRE ebooks which will help you. Firdaus, why did you not go beyond 3x6 in the last question? Because there are only four people who are throwing the dice once, right? So first person, second person, third person, and the fourth person. You don't have to go beyond four persons, right? So by the time we have reached the fourth person, it's only 3x6, correct? That is the reason why you don't go beyond 3x6 in the last question. Not a problem. You're welcome. Yes. What else? What other questions do you guys have? So this is a very important resource that I want all of you to take notice of, the flashcards that we have, which are designed for an Indian audience. I'm copy pasting the link here. Please, I strongly recommend that you go through some of these flashcards, because as you know, GRE is a vocabulary intensive exam test. So it makes sense for you to have as many resources, good resources on improving your vocabulary. See, for those, I just missed one question. So I will probably copy paste it here. Right. And you can probably solve it. Take down and then solve, right? It's just one question that I missed. So that's about it, guys. If there are any other questions, I'll take them up. Otherwise, we'll call it today. Thank you, Vijay. You're welcome. I appreciate your feedback. I'm happy that you like the session. Yeah. Any other questions can be typed in the chat box. Shikha, I've copy pasted the links in the chat box. Can you please scroll up? You can see all the links in the chat box. You're welcome, Firdaus. It's my job, but I'm glad that you like the webinar. Okay, guys, so In case there are no other questions, I think we'll call it a day. You've all been a wonderful audience. Thanks for being patient, and hope to see you in CrackVerbal shortly. In case you're not a student already, hope to see you in our classes or taking up our online sessions and reaping the benefits of the great products that we have. All right. Okay. Thanks a lot. Have a nice evening, all of you. And see you some other time then. Thank you, guys.